On November 13th, 1939, at 60 years old, Lois Weber passed away in the hospital. She died bankrupt, and her death went largely unnoticed around Hollywood. But 25 years earlier, at the beginning of motion picture history, Weber was a titan. Directing over 135 films, Weber was the first woman to own her own studio, the first woman to direct a feature-length film. Her name was mentioned in the same breath with D.W. Griffith, Cecil B. DeMille, and Charlie Chaplin. She effortlessly moved between working as an actor, director, producer, and writer of her pictures. What happened to Lois Weber, and how does she remain largely forgotten today? Weber was born in Pennsylvania in 1879. She wanted to be a singer, and from her singing, she discovered the theater, began acting, writing, and directing for the stage. But it wasn't long after being in theater that she became aware of the very new medium of motion pictures. Weber was 29 when she met Alice Guy Blaschet. Guy was an early silent film innovator. So in 1908, Weber began singing songs for Guy's chronophone company, recording music to be played from a phonogram alongside early silent films. But Weber soon found herself writing scripts for Gaumont, and she quickly moved to directing for the Rex Motion Picture Company that same year. It was in these first years directing that she found her distinctive style and began to build a reputation as an important filmmaker. But it wasn't until 1913, with the making of her film Suspense, that the extent of her genius began to show. When we look at Suspense now, it's very clear that the film shows a level of structural complexity that puts it far ahead of its time. Weber intuitively understood that editing could be so much more than it was currently being used for. She's one of the first filmmakers to use intercutting, first established in films like Porter's Great Train Robbery, to cut between three points of action in the story. Weber shows us a vagrant trying to break into a woman's home, the woman and her baby, and the woman's husband charging to the home with police officers. This alone says a lot about Weber's intuitive sense of cinema's screen space and its ability to communicate moment-to-moment tension, but her real genius shows in a maneuver that turned out to be the cinema's first experiment with action split across multiple planes on the screen. In a single frame, Weber shows us the three lines of narrative intrigue, composed like a stained glass window. This is the first recognition that the screen plane could be more than just a keyhole to view an action or an event, that it represented an imaginary field where emotion, thought, and our subjective experience of reality can be composed by the director. It is the recognition of cinema not merely as a way of seeing, but as a way of thinking, where Porter's Great Train Robbery was an early example of how screen time can be sculpted to transport us across distances. Weber demonstrated here that screen space can similarly be shaped to show us separate, parallel realities. The following year, Weber was at the height of her powers. She directed 27 short silent films, and with the making of her films Merchant of Venice and Hypocrites, she became the first female director of feature films. 1914 also saw Weber begin to become the leader in socially conscious filmmaking in American cinema. She began to infuse in each of her films social and moral messages that often courted controversy. In her film Where Are My Children, she endorsed birth control for women at a time when promotion of literature explaining birth control to the public was still illegal. She began to frequently take on the subject of women and their relationship with society before women could even vote. Weber was tackling astonishing social issues in her films, many of which we're still grappling with today. Abortion, capital punishment, these are all issues she engaged with prior to the introduction of sound into cinema. After achieving success, she formed her own motion picture studio. Over the next 4 years, she would produce dozens of films under this label. Things began to change for Weber in 1921 when she screened one of her boldest films yet for executives at Paramount. Her film, What Do Men Want?, was her most direct engagement with power imbalances between men and women. Feeling that Weber had gone too far and that the mood of filmgoers was changing, the company refused to honor her distribution agreement. The failure of this film probably cost Weber one of the most lucrative distribution deals ever signed in Hollywood at that time, and it signaled a change in her career, foreshadowing the changes to come for the many other female directors, writers, and producers working in Hollywood in the early 20s. Releasing one of her best-known works, The Blot, in 1921, Weber walked away from the cinema. At the height of her career, she set sail for Europe with her husband to see if they could save their struggling marriage. When she would return in 1923, she sought a divorce. Her return would be difficult and mark a period of profound struggle, financially and creatively. She came back to a Hollywood where a new studio system was beginning to thrive. As companies like Universal, Paramount, and RKO began to crystallize their industrial processing of feature films and leverage their exhibition monopolies, small pseudo-indie outfits like Weber Studio were unable to compete. Working for a studio as a hired director meant accepting creative limitations that Weber resisted. As the owner of her own studio, she had an opportunity to enjoy full independence as a filmmaker. She could write challenging stories that had meaningful messages. She could work at a pace that suited the film she was trying to create, and she knew she could protect her final cut of the film. And with the rise of censorship codes, it's unclear if Weber could even continue to make her brand of morally nuanced films. After returning to Hollywood in 1923, Weber would only direct 5 more feature films. His next 10 years would be difficult and not result in the success that she was used to. With her final film, White Heat, she attempted to make the jump to sound, directing her only talkie. That film, Lois's last work, is considered lost. When Weber died in 1939, only a few paragraphs would be written about her in trade magazines. She was already almost completely forgotten. Like so much of the work of the silent era, very little remains. What we have now are just fragments of her enormous output, with the rest seemingly lost to history. There is so much we may never know about Lois Weber, but what we do know is that she is worth remembering. What Weber's story reveals is that in the pre-studio history of Hollywood, there was a wild west of opportunity. Many filmmakers worked closer to the way we understand contemporary independent filmmaking to operate, securing their own financing, partnering with a distributor, and retaining freedom in production to produce work that meets a specific vision. And once you recognize that, it becomes possible to imagine a Hollywood that never crystallized a studio system with competitive advantages over smaller companies. The Hollywood that left Weber behind had accepted many of the biases and limited beliefs that for a brief time had a limited influence on the film industry. As any culture ceases to remain a wild and new frontier, the rules and norms obeyed by the rest of society find a way of reasserting themselves. Such was the case with Hollywood, a world where women were welcomed to compete with men as directors, entrepreneurs, and producers, faded into the forgotten memory of our recent past. And so too did the cinema of Lois Weber, which still remains vibrant, challenging, and visionary.